So let's move on to gene regulation. And if you recall, the DNA is the same in all cells of the individual. Then the cell decides which snippets of the DNA to transcribe into RNA. That's called gene regulation. And then from the RNA, the cell makes the proteins it needs. So what we're going to talk about now is how each cell decides which snippets to make and put that into context of genome scale regulation and organization. Again, the information in RNA, you already know this now, is RNA is a single-stranded molecule. There is a portion that's not translated. The coding sequence is what is translated into protein, and then there's another portion that's not translated. Parenthetically, these are mostly for RNA regulation and also regulation of stability as well as degradation. For most intents and purposes, it's the coding sequence that matters. A typical RNA, a typical mRNA, messenger RNA, is about 1,000 bases long. And you can back that out of the fact that a typical protein is approximately 300 amino acids long. Of course, there's a very wide range, as we talked about last time. But 300 is a good number to remember as sort of, you know, order of magnitude. So 300 amino acids are encoded by 900 nucleotides, right? One amino acid, three nucleotides, the codon, the genetic code. And then plus a couple hundred bases of 5' untranslated and 3' untranslated regions. So it's approximately 1,000 bases. But when you look at the genome, you will find that the RNA occupies, the portion that codes for the RNA actually occupies a much, much larger region. And just to cartoon it out a little bit, here's the base pair level. You zoom out, you get something longer. You zoom out further, and you have 10,000 base pairs. So, no, this is a fairly typical situation where RNA is actually made as a much, much longer molecule to start with. And what you will find is that the RNA sequence matches the DNA sequence in a discontinuous way. So if this is your RNA sequence, and I'm sorry, I'm using T instead of U because it's the same, you will find that the matching happens in a massively discontinuous way. And then it goes on over here, etc. Now, the scale here is not quite correct. There are, in fact, many more nucleotides, but this gives you the idea. It is discontinuous. And the names for these discontinuous pieces is exon and intron. So what happens in reality is that a long RNA is transcribed. It's called the pre-mRNA. And that only certain snippets are retained in the final spliced mRNA. And what happens is that there is a protein machinery, the so-called spliceosome, that goes through and finds certain signals in the DNA sequence, some of which are depicted here, and understands that these are places where this particular base here, which is not written out here, the end of this red box, is supposed to get hooked up to this particular place here, the beginning of this red box, such that these then get hooked up together. And what happens is that through a series of chemical reactions, that this particular piece here of the RNA gets spliced out and eventually degraded. And you can see some of the molecular interactions that happen here. This G, in fact, is hooked up to this A in a sort of an unusual bond, makes this so-called lariat, and that goes away then. And now you've spliced these two exons together into the contiguous mRNA sequence. So in the genome, the mRNA sequence is encoded in a discontinuous manner. And the exons are those pieces that contain the mature RNA, the mature messenger RNA, and the introns get eliminated. The discontinuous nature of how the information is encoded, the information for RNA is encoded in the genome, is the first complication that arises when you start to talk about the nature of the gene. Okay, so let me digress for a moment into what is a gene. And if you recall from high school biology, Mendel figured out what a gene is, or defined what a gene is, on the basis of the inferred cause of a heritable trait. Okay, so he had yellow peas and green peas, and the difference between them segregated and was transmitted in generations as discrete traits. And he inferred from that that there is something called the gene that encodes that information. And he also had smooth and wrinkly, and again, same thing. He inferred from the difference in the phenotype there is an underlying gene. Now, it's a pretty abstract concept, and nowadays, given that we know the physical basis for genes, our definition has expanded a little bit, and it's really anchored mostly in the DNA. And so what we refer to as a gene nowadays is the DNA section that encodes and regulates the expression of a functional protein or RNA. So to us nowadays, the gene is basically where RNA is made to then produce a functional protein or non-coding RNA, about which we haven't talked very much, but there are also RNAs that, there's a handful of RNAs that perform certain functions. So we've divorced the idea of a gene to some extent from the fact that there is genetic variation and phenotypes, and have embraced the notion that a gene is the physical entity that encodes that information, and that does not necessarily have to have genetic variation. So nowadays we can have genes, we talk about genes all the time, not in the context of genetic variation. So that's pretty much the modern definition of it. And it is a little bit complicated when you begin to consider that genes can be discontinuous, as we just saw with respect to exons and introns. And it gets even more complicated when we talk about genetic regulation, gene regulation, where the regulatory regions that turn RNA on or off are actually scattered about in places that sometimes don't make any sense, really, that are hard to understand. Okay, let's get a sense of the scale here. So, as I explained earlier, we have discontinuous nature of exons, and what you see here is a zoom in to approximately 200,000 base pairs of a region on chromosome 7 that encodes the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator, the CFTR gene. So this gene, when defective, unfortunately predisposes to cystic fibrosis. And you can see by these vertical lines, which are the exons, how many exons there are, first of all, in this particular gene, and how there isn't really any rhyme or reason to their spacing. Some introns are really large, and some introns are not so large, and some are really tiny. and it seems to vary a great deal. the direction of transcription is indicated by these fishbone markers. So this is encoded on the Watson strand. If the fishbone markers were going that way, it would be encoded on the Crick strand. And now zooming in a little bit, we see here, this section here is the beginning of the gene. There's an exon that contains the untranslated region, and then this is where translation will start in the RNA. Zooming in further, and then further finally to see base pair level. So now you have the individual base pairs. That gives you a sense, these are 20 base pairs. Gives you a sense of the scale here. So this is 100,000 base pairs. So this is approximately 25,000, yes, 5,000-fold difference in scale. And again, you can see how very little space the exons take up and how there is a lot of space that the introns take up. CFTR is a gene that, of course, lives in a neighborhood of other genes on its chromosome, on chromosome 7. So it's approximately 200 kb long, and next to it is another gene. Don't worry too much about the fact that there are two versions written here. Think of this as one gene, one, two, three, four genes in this neighborhood. And zooming out further, you will see, you know, many more genes, of course. Now we're looking at approximately 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 million base pairs, a portion of chromosome 7. And here's a gene called FOXP2, MDFIC, et cetera, lots and lots of genes. And you can, again, see how large the introns are compared to the exons. And in fact, at this resolution, you wouldn't even be able to see the exons if you didn't have to put a pixel here in order to show it. So very large introns, quite a bit of intergenic space at times, like between this one and the next one, there's a lot of space where this doesn't seem to be a gene. Similarly over here, a lot of space where there doesn't seem to be a gene. So this alteration of genes and intergenic regions and the discontinuous nature of exons gives you a bit of a visceral feel of what the genome looks like. Now, it really is a hodgepodge. Here is the CFTR gene, the cystic fibrosis gene. It is a transmembrane channel. It regulates chloride ion flow across epithelial cell membranes in most epithelial cells. And if it's non-functional, chloride ions don't flow properly and mucus builds up for various reasons downstream. And then you get cystic fibrosis. So this is a ion transporter on epithelial cells. This protein here is a transcriptional regulator. It's responsible for hooking up neurons in the brain. And in fact, if this gene doesn't function properly, you have articulation defects. You can't speak very well at all because the neurons in your speech centers aren't properly hooked up. This is an integral membrane protein that participates in plasma membrane protein transport. It's present in most cell types. Here's a transmembrane protein receptor that's responsible for cell growth. If it's constitutively activated, you get cancer because it tells the cell to keep dividing. And this is a developmental regulatory protein involved in pattern formation. It's secreted by cells. Other neighboring cells have a receptor for it, and so they talk to one another and they participate in pattern formation in the early embryo, and so it's expressed in distinct regions in the early embryo. So you have this hodgepodge of genes that are really not functionally related at all. And in fact, it is the exception in the genome to have many genes together that are functionally related. One exception is, for example, the beta hemoglobins. Your beta hemoglobin is in a family of genes that are other hemoglobins as well. Some of which are expressed as in the embryo. They are sort of coordinately regulated, and so they sit together so that they can participate in coordinate regulation. And next door to that particular hemoglobin cluster is a cluster of olfactory receptors. Those are smell proteins that interact with chemicals in the air. And they too are somewhat coordinately regulated, and so they sit in the same place as the genome. But those kinds of clusters are the exception. The rule is really that you have genes that are unrelated to one another being neighbors in the genome. So, gene summary. In modern usage, a gene is a transcription unit. And its regulatory sequences, which we'll talk about in the next section, that produce a gene product. In other words, a protein-coding RNA or non-coding RNA that performs a function. The structure of a gene in eukaryotes is that exons alternate with introns. In terms of dimensions, human genes' introns are much, much longer than exons, which average only about 150 base pairs. And introns are excised and exons spliced together to form an mRNA. And remember, introns and exons, you can see them in the DNA, but the actual physical conversions happen in the RNA. Okay, so this is not DNA that gets spliced together. This is at the RNA level where the splicing occurs. And in terms of organization, neighboring genes often have nothing to do with each other. Intergenic spaces are long and introns are long, and exons are only about 1.5% of the human genome. Now that we know what a gene is, we can start talking about how genes are turned on and off. So far, we haven't really addressed that at all, right? I showed you in the CFTR region that there are various genes, all of which have different functions, and all of which are expressed in at different times and in different tissues and in different cell types, and somehow all of that has to be regulated. So that's gene regulation, and just to gene regulation it comes in two flavors. One is transcriptional regulation, and the other one is at the splicing level. So we're going to start with transcriptional regulation, which is really the bulk of gene regulatory machinery. Now, in case it's not already obvious, the purpose of gene regulation is to turn the genes on that a particular cell type needs, or really that define a cell type, if you will. Because a cell really is, if you will, an emergent property of all the genes that turn on in it and all of their functions. And so a hungry cell that wants to grow because it's been told that it needs to divide in a little while will express genes that encode proteins that bring nutrients into the cell. A neuron will express genes that encode proteins that that facilitate electrical signaling across the cell membrane. So membrane channels that let ions through, as well as, for example, genes that encode proteins that make cell connections at the synapse so that an upstream cell can signal to the downstream cell via the release of neurotransmitters, etc. A muscle cell, of course, needs to express all those muscle proteins that we talked about in the last set of lectures, the actins and the myosins and the titins and so forth that allow you to then move muscles. And I love this example, the selfless cell, which has been told that it needs to die, has to express all of these degenerative enzymes that cut apart DNA and cut apart proteins and digest everything so that it can self-destruct. Now, obviously, you wouldn't want to have those proteins expressed in your brain at the wrong time in a cell that's supposed to function as a neuron. And you don't want the conductance channels of the brain be expressed in your muscle cell. That would mess up the electrical activity of the muscle cells. So, gene expression has to be finely tuned. The genes that are not supposed to be on in a particular cell really have to be off. And the proteins that need to be expressed in the cell in order to perform its function really have to be on. And they have to be on at just the right level, of course. Some proteins you need in very, very small quantities. You know, for example, certain regulatory proteins that are involved in transcriptional regulation might be very rare. Whereas, for example, hemoglobin in your red blood cells is present at literally thousands of copies. So all of this has to be done, and much of it happens at the transcriptional level. So that is not to say that there aren't other opportunities to regulate, okay? So what we'll mostly be talking about is regulation at the transcriptional level. Splicing, of course, provides another opportunity to regulate. And, of course, translation itself provides another opportunity to regulate. So what I'm talking about here is not to say that there aren't these other layers of regulation that would just, really explode the content of the course if we went into all of those things in great detail. But gene regulation in particular is important in the context of genetic testing, because we would like to understand not just the exons that encode protein, but also the regulatory regions that regulate the expression of RNAs. So many opportunities for regulation along the information flow, but arguably the most well-studied and possibly the most important one is transcriptional regulation. Here's the concept. Here's my chromosome. Of course, it's made of DNA. It turns out that, as I mentioned before, even in the interface cell that's doing its job, it's not dividing, it's not doing DNA replication, it's just doing its job, even in that cell, large portions of the chromosome are packaged away and are not accessible to the regulatory machinery. In those places where the regulatory machinery is accessible, or where the DNA is accessible to the regulatory machinery, the concept is fairly simple. You have proteins called transcription factors, which I will show you in a moment, specifically recognize short sequence motifs, short 4 to 20 base pair sequence motifs, physically recognize them, and therefore bind only in that place where that sequence is present and not somewhere else. And these transcription factors tell RNA polymerase, the protein complex that makes RNA from, that transcribes RNA using DNA as the template, tell RNA polymerase to go. RNA polymerase transcribes and makes RNA. And so this happens in regions of the genome that are accessible to the transcription factors, and not in regions of the genome that are not accessible. And of course, it happens not just over here, but it might happen over there too, potentially with a different set of transcription factors, and potentially producing less RNA than at this locus here. So the regulation is essentially the binding of transcription factors. Here are two crystal structures of two unrelated transcription factors, and I'm embarrassed to say that I'm actually forgetting what they are, but the names here are really not that important. To remind you, these helical regions are a particular protein secondary structure, alpha helix, and these are beta strands. So what you want to imagine here is not just this cartoon of how the backbone is, but actually the full physical protein and all of its atoms. And some amino acid side chains in strategic places stick out, and their atoms make very specific contacts with very specific atoms in the DNA. Okay, so the contacts probably happen along this surface here with this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or so base pairs of DNA. And so this transcription factor can bind that particular bit of DNA because that's what the sequence is right there, okay? Now, this is a completely different transcription factor, and you can see that its structure is really quite different. It has these so-called leucine zippers, these two strands of backbone where the residues interact with one another in sort of a zipper-like way. And they together embrace the DNA and then make contacts between the side chains here and the DNA in a probably different base sequence than this. I mean, not just probably, it's certainly different. So probably along 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then over here. So this is probably a much longer recognition sequence for this transcription factor than for this one. This looks like only like 5 or 6 bases. This more looks like 1, 2, maybe up to 20 bases, actually. So these things come in all kinds of structures and flavors. There are various families of transcription factors. So I just mentioned this leucine zipper bit here. There are several transcription factors that have this kind of motif, but differ in exactly what they do here, and so therefore differ in the DNA sequences that they bind. And then, you know, there are various subclasses and then larger classes. And so I think in aggregate, and I forget the exact number, but I think the human genome has on the order of 1,000 or so transcription factors, about 1/20 of its genes, all of which, or many of which, recognize different DNA sequences and therefore regulate different genes. So, right, they don't just bind to DNA non-specifically, they bind to their DNA, to their specific sequences. And those typical recognition sites are somewhere between 4 and 20 base pairs. There are some that are longer, some that are quite short. And before I forget to say this, you can imagine that a recognition site of 4 base pairs occurs in the genome actually quite frequently by chance. And so somehow the cell has figured out to only have the transcription factor bind in the places where it ought to bind, even though this 4 base pair motif is present in many different places. So there are additional layers of regulation that I'm not going to get into, many of which have to do that transcription factors actually, most of the time, work in gangs. Several different transcription factors coming together in the same regulatory region. And this combinatorial assortment provides a great degree of specificity so that, you know, really if this transcription factor binds its 4 base pairs, it's helped by another transcription factor next door that binds another sequence. And so now you've extended essentially the recognition sequence to something that is more unique in the genome than just those 4 base pairs. Okay. So again, here's a cartoon to orient you. That's the promoter. And I would like to make the point, again, this is a fairly important point. The promoter is a specific word that denotes the place where RNA polymerase sits down before it starts transcription. That's the promoter. There's no other definition for the promoter. That's what it is, where RNA polymerase binds, okay? So here's the promoter. This is where transcription will start. There's going to be a transcription stop signal, usually an AT-rich signal, some distance, maybe 1 kb, maybe 10 kb, maybe 100,000 base pairs away. We have an enhancer that binds transcription factors that eventually will turn on RNA polymerase. We have other elements such as insulators that insulators basically provide, they're like a wall, if you will. So something is supposed to happen over here and something is supposed to happen over there, but it's not supposed to be talking to one another. So you got an insulator that makes them separate functions. And in this particular example, there's another gene here that has a promoter and a stop signal. But this gene is kept off, possibly by the chromatin having been packed together so that this really isn't open, or by particular transcription factors called repressors that really keep that gene off. And just as a side note, there's a particularly well-studied repressor called NRSF that is expressed in almost all cell types except neurons, and its job is to turn off neuronal genes, channels in particular, in all other cell types so that they don't mess with the membrane potential, you know, of a liver cell or a muscle cell. So there's sort of an extra layer of lockdown on those particular genes so that they really don't get expressed in anything but neurons. So in neurons, this guy comes off, and then it can be expressed. In all other cell types, this guy sits there and keeps it down. So that was just one specific example of a repressor, because we usually talk about gene regulation in an activating sense, okay? And that's what this is. The transcription factors bind the enhancer, and then the enhancer makes contact with the RNA polymerase that's sitting there, and now these transcription factors literally turn on polymerase so that it will go until it hits the stop sign and make RNA. And it is organized such that this only happens over here. There's an insulator that keeps that away. These are expressed in this particular cell type, and therefore they bind in this place, and then when they bind here, they tell polymerase to go. So this is sort of one snapshot, and you know, you have 20,000 genes, and in any given cell, perhaps 10,000 of them are active, so you have to imagine that there's about 10,000 of these, and about 10,000 of these, and these work independently of one another, any given gene has different sequences here in this enhancer that tell that allow different transcription factors to bind and therefore be regulated independently from one another. At another level of organization, it gets a little more complicated, but I did want to show you this. Recall that DNA is not naked like that, okay? Everywhere in the genome, even when it's not DNA that's packaged away in higher order packing, everywhere in the genome, the DNA is wrapped around histones. And in fact, as RNA polymerase runs through and transcribes RNA at a rate of about 50 bases per second, it actually elbows away the nucleosomes that are sitting here on the DNA and gets rid of them so that it can transcribe. And then when it's gone past and the DNA goes back to its double-stranded state behind the RNA polymerase, the nucleosomes hop back on. And so everywhere, basically at all times, DNA is wrapped around nucleosomes. And that's what's depicted here. Let me start with explaining this for a moment because it's easier, because these nucleosomes are all nicely, densely packed. There have been signals that have been deposited on these nucleosomes, covalent modifications by histone methyltransferases, for example, that basically tell the cellular machinery to just package this away, okay? So this is an inactive picture where you see not much else going on other than just the nucleosomes sitting there. This can be converted into an active picture by the actions of certain enzymes, gene regulatory enzymes, that put marks onto these histones and then therefore tell the cellular machinery to open up the chromatin and let transcription factors bind, okay? So here, a nucleosome was kicked out and transcription factors can now bind here and can interact at some, either very close by or at some distance with RNA polymerase, which will then go on to transcribe. Okay, so this level of regulation is usually referred to as chromatin remodeling, because you're taking away histones and so that transcription factors can bind. And it's an energy-dependent process by the various enzymes. So there's literally protein machinery that elbows the histones out of the way. Chromatin remodeling. And then these covalent modifications on the histones themselves are so-called chromatin marks. There is a large diversity of them, but not super large, so that they actually serve as kind of useful markers for researchers to understand which genes are active and which genes are inactive. And I'll show you a couple of examples of that as we go along. So again, here, genes are switched on by chromatin remodeling and allowing transcription factors to bind. And here, the gene is switched off by keeping everything packed away. So let's look at what that looks like in that favorite region of ours that we've been seeing earlier. So again, for orientation, here is the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulated CFTR gene. This is a very similar picture from what I showed you earlier. Again, here's the exons. This gene is transcribed when it is transcribed, from here, and transcription stop is over here. Not so far away from that gene, as you can tell by these coordinates. So this is base pair number 117,550,000, right there. This is base pair number 116,860,000 right here. So this sits in relation to CFTR, it sits over here. This gene, again, is transcribed in that direction. And so here we have the promoter, and then there's a huge intron, more than 30 kb before you get to the next exon and so forth. And that's the stop. And here's another gene. And again, the different versions shouldn't bother you too much. That's done by splicing. So let's just pick one of these and look at that. Same thing, transcribed from here to over there. The scale is just slightly bigger than, slightly more zoomed in than CFTR, but regardless. So what I wanted to show you in relation to where the exons are, I wanted to show you some regulatory regions. And I could have drawn boxes for the regulatory regions, but they'd be hard to see. And so what I did instead is I turned on a track that shows a certain type of signal that comes from experimental assays. And this particular signal shows you active gene regulatory regions, enhancers and promoters. And it was determined in 7 different cell types. Okay, so not in all cell types. So we're not seeing all of the regulation that can happen here. We're only seeing the regulation in the handful of cell types that were assayed here. And parenthetically, that's a really important point, okay? The DNA is the same in all of your cells. But the regulation, of course, differs greatly between cell types. And so depending on which cell you're looking at, which cell you're assaying, you will get very different results for which genes are on and which genes are off and how on and off they are. Okay, so these are tracks that were determined from 7 different cell types, and so it's not comprehensive, but rather sort of an example of where the regulatory regions are. Now, let's look at this one here first. There's a great deal of signal around the promoter. That's very typical because the promoter is open chromatin. It has a certain histone modification, certain nucleosome modification on it that's being assayed here. And so this is in general a general regulatory region that's rather active, if you will. And you can see there are several more regulatory regions that are really quite active. And there's one upstream here. And all of these interact in some complex way with the promoter to tell RNA polymerase to go. This particular gene in these cell types is under very, very fine-tuned, very complex regulation. as you can tell by these various DNA elements that via their transcription factors that bind to them, impinge on the promoter. This gene here, you'll see the signals are, there's a big signal at the promoter, there's a signal here in the first intron, another signal in the first intron, and that seems to be actually cell type specific, as you can tell by the different colors here. But this regulation seems to be a little bit less complex, okay? Probably it's a gene that just needs to be turned on or off, and the level is probably kind of hard-coded. It doesn't require too much fine-tuning. And then here, you have CFTR, which is off in these cell types, because there's no signal here on the promoter. But just because it's off, it doesn't mean that there isn't a promoter, right? There is a promoter here, and if we had assayed the right cell type, we would see a signal here at the promoter. The reason I'm going over all of this in such detail is that I wanted to give you a slight flavor for the uncertainty of the information that we have with respect to gene regulatory regions. There's been a great deal of progress in recent years, but it's still a difficult endeavor to really show that a particular region does something in regulation and in which cell types and especially in which parts of the body it does so. Figuring out where exons are is a much easier endeavor because all you have to do is compare RNA with DNA and then that comparison tells you where the exons are. That's a very quick rundown of gene regulation, of active gene regulation at the transcription level, because now I'm just going to show you really quick at the splicing level what gene regulation looks like there. You've seen this cartoon before. Here's your RNA that was just transcribed. Maybe it's 10 kb long, 10,000 base pairs long. It has long introns that need to be gotten rid of, and the exons are put together to make an mRNA. And this process, too, is regulated. And I'm showing you again this MET gene here that we've seen before, where I was telling you not to pay attention to these different versions to begin with. But now I'm asking you to please pay attention to these different versions, because what they reflect is that splicing regulation. You see, here's an exon that's present in these three isoforms, but it's absent from this isoform. So the protein that's being made from this isoform is missing a big chunk, probably a couple hundred amino acids from the looks of it. And then continues with common exons. This isoform here stops at this place, so it's missing the protein, the peptide sequence, the protein sequence that is present in these isoforms beyond that particular place. So it's effectively a truncated protein, okay? So splicing can give you structurally different proteins, even though they come from the same gene, okay? Transcriptional regulation is whether something is off or on, and if it's on, at what level. Splicing regulation gives you different versions of the same protein. And usually the versions are functionally similar. Maybe it's just fine-tuning that happens here a little bit. But oftentimes, the splicing differences, the alternative splices, can give rise to functionally quite distinct proteins. So one example is, for example, a transcription factor. We make a protein, it's a transcription factor, okay? So a transcription factor needs two places in the protein, two domains of activity. One is the DNA binding domain. That's where its protein configuration binds very specifically to a particular base pair sequence. Okay, that's a transcription factor binding domain, DNA binding domain. And then it needs to have another domain that interacts with RNA polymerase, or potentially with other transcription factors as well, that engages in protein-protein interaction so that it can tell RNA polymerase to go. Okay, so two domains in the same protein. Many transcription factors come in two flavors. One, the full protein with the activating domain and the DNA binding domain. And another, as the evil counterpart, where the transcription factor is missing the activating domain. And so all it does is bind the DNA. And guess what that does? It represses, okay? And the balance between these two can finely tune whether a gene is expressed or not. So if the splicing machinery decides to make the full-length protein, then that transcription factor will act as an activating way to turn on the genes. But if the splicing machinery makes the repressor, then that repressor will compete with the other version and potentially turn its target genes off. Okay? So that's gene regulation. Again, transcriptional regulation determines the initial level of RNA production and, of course, whether a gene is expressed at all in the cell. It's executed by transcription factors, which are DNA binding proteins that have specific structures that recognize specific DNA sequences. They tell, via their transcriptional activation domain, RNA polymerase to go. Repressors keep genes off. And chromatin remodelers move nucleosomes around and facilitate the sort of the poised state where RNA polymerase is bound to the promoter and is waiting for a signal to go, versus the silent state where there's no RNA polymerase bound. Chromatin modifications, so these little modifiers that get tacked onto histones, are markers of the activity of genes and of regulatory regions. So there can be activating marks as well as repressing marks. The regulatory regions themselves, the short snippets of DNA that bind the transcription factors, are usually in the vicinity of the promoter on which they act. But they don't have to be very close in eukaryotic genomes, in large genomes. They don't have to be very close. In bacterial genomes, they're usually right there. But in our genomes, which are so vast and have introns and so forth, they can be very far away. In fact, they can be in introns even. And it's kind of paradoxical, isn't it? There is a protein regulator that in an intron that binds, that tells RNA polymerase to go. So then RNA polymerase will have to go through that as it transcribes the gene. Amazing. And they can be very far away. And then RNA processing, splicing can also be regulated to make functionally distinct versions of the same protein. So with all of this complexity, introns, exons, regulatory regions, genes on and off, let's look at how all of that information is organized above the base pair, or above the gene level, and look at genome organization and information density. So as we said before, exons really don't take up that much space. In fact, in this visual representation, given the scale, these vertical lines that denote the exons shouldn't even be there. They are so tiny. Okay, so this is an overestimate, a visual overestimate of how much exon there is. So then what does take up so much space if exons are only 1.5% of the genome? Well, one answer that we've already had is that there are regulatory regions that occupy a significant portion of the genome. This is a very highly regulated gene, so the density of these regulatory regions is a bit higher than average. We think that approximately 10% of the genome exists in regulatory regions. People argue about this a lot. 10% is my personal opinion. Some people think that it's much higher, but I don't think so. So at any rate, there is a lot of DNA that doesn't seem to be involved in any productive biological process. And so what is it? Well, I would love to give a whole lecture on this because it is fascinating, but it has to do with the selfish gene. And I don't mean the gene in the sense of a protein coding gene that does something for the human, but I mean the selfish gene in the sense that there are DNA elements that are actually capable of replicating themselves and then at a certain low but appreciable frequency somewhere, you know, hop into other places in the genome. So these elements are called short interspersed nuclear elements or long interspersed nuclear elements. The short ones are about 300 base pairs long. The long ones are approximately 5 to 7 kb long. They come in various flavors, but they tend to be they tend to come from a relatively small number of families. In humans, the genetic element that is probably best known is called the ALU element. About 10% of our genome is made up of these ALU elements that arose somewhere between now and 10 million years ago. And they basically are our genome parasites. They're little snippets of DNA that subvert transcriptional machinery to make RNA copies of themselves. And every once in a while, though we haven't talked about it, RNA is reverse transcribed back into DNA. It happens rarely, but it does happen. And in fact, these parasites, the bigger parasites, encode the protein that does that. Okay, so it gets back into DNA, and then the DNA integrates back into the genome. Now, this is not something that happens all the time and all over the place. What you're seeing here is the result, of course, of hundreds of millions of years of evolution and basically DNA turnover. But these mobile elements, as they're generically referred to, do make up a very significant portion of our genome. Since the beginning of mammalian evolution about 300 million years ago, or perhaps, yeah, thereabouts, there have been multiple such families that have evolved, and at this point our genome is detectably derived, about 50% of it is detectably derived from these mobile elements. And you can kind of tell that, you know, the density of these things is pretty high, and most of them don't do anything for you. They just contribute bulk to your DNA. Okay, and if you don't believe me, I give you the pufferfish, okay? The pufferfish, arguably, is an organism that is as complex as a human. So we have a bigger brain. That's about it, okay? Other than that, same thing. But the pufferfish genome is much, much more compact than the human genome. It doesn't tolerate those mobile elements very much. It kicks them back out, basically, as soon as they hop in. And so the density of information in the pufferfish genome, both in terms of exons as well as regulatory regions, is about eightfold higher than in the human genome, where regulatory regions are very far apart and exons on average are even further spaced apart. So to those who claim that most of the human genome is functional, I give them the pufferfish genome. If the pufferfish genome can do with a genome that's 1/8 the size of a human genome, we could too. But evolution hasn't worked out that way. We have a whole bunch of junk DNA from these genome parasites that are scattered across the genome. And so sifting the signal in terms of the regulatory regions from and the exons from the noise is actually not straightforward. And so the human genome contains, you know, many, many sequences that are irrelevant, basically. And the information density is not particularly high. So having talked about the pufferfish, let me just give you a sense of some other organisms, and you can read up on this if you're so inclined. Just to orient you really quick, eukaryotes are the nucleate, the organisms with a nucleus, where the chromosomes are linear. Animals, plants, fungi, and then various unicellular protists. Eukaryotic genomes come in these kinds of sizes. I've just written out a handful of examples. I'll show you a chart in the next slide. Here we are with about 3 gigabases, 3 billion bases. Mice are slightly smaller. Bats are even slightly smaller, but that's sort of the range within mammals. The fugu has only 400,000 bases. The chicken has 1.2 billion bases. So that's all more or less in the same ballpark. When you go to plants, you have a gigantic variance in genome size. So the mustard weed Arabidopsis, a favorite model organism, its genome is only 125,000 base pairs. Redwood, 32 billion base pairs. And again, you know, redwood is no more complicated than Arabidopsis. The reason redwood has so much DNA is because it's so much junk DNA. Prokaryotes, bacteria, and bacteria-like single-cell organism called archaea, which are really, really ancient, and bacteria-like, also single-celled, they have closed circular genomes that tend to be small, somewhere between 1 and 10 million base pairs. For us, for vertebrates, the typical number of genes is about 20,000. And so again, as I mentioned, I think in an earlier lecture, if you classify these into specific functions, you probably have on the order of 15,000 different functions that are related. But of course, the regulatory elaboration, as well as certain gene duplicates that give slightly different versions of proteins, makes for a much larger universe of different functional space. So 15,000, 20,000 genes, but of course, with all of the regulatory diversity that is possible in a much larger universe of specific functions. Okay, so those are genome sizes. Here is just a chart where you see the range. Flowering plants have a really, really wide range, over three orders of magnitude. Mammals are relatively narrow. Mollusks are relatively narrow. Oh, that's birds. Mollusks are a little wider. But anyway, you can take a look. Usually, more simple organisms have smaller genomes, but as you can see here, the variance is so large that it doesn't really make any rhyme or reason with respect to functional complexity of the organism. It's all just accidents of evolution, mostly. All right, human genome is about 3 gigabases, 1.5% is exons, maybe 10% is transcriptional regulatory regions. There's huge amounts of DNA that are derived from mobile elements.